Welcome to the You World Order Showcase Podcast. Your host, Jill Hart, the coach's alchemist. Couldn't be more excited to have you join us today. On this podcast, we celebrate the champions of change, the up-and-coming life, health and transformational coaches who are fearlessly stepping forward to make a difference in the world. Get ready for inspiring stories, practical tips, and powerful moments that will motivate you to make a positive change in your life and those around you. We're happy to have you join us on this incredible journey as we dive into the world of life, health, and transformational coaches who are lighting up the path towards a better tomorrow.
Hi, and welcome to the You World Order Showcase Podcast. Today, we are speaking with Elizabeth Meigs. Elizabeth specializes in helping people find inspiration to live happier lives. And it's based, I'm pretty sure, on her story, which she is going to tell us. It's an incredible journey that she's been on. I can tell you that. So welcome, Elizabeth. We're really glad to have you with us today.
Thank you for having me. I feel so blessed to be on here and get to share my story. I was essentially a beautiful 14-year-old girl. I was going after my dreams. I had been a singer and a performer since the age of 7, had been taking voice lessons, very popular, played every sport, cheerleader, had my whole life going for me. Had been in a recording studio cutting a demo tapes in the spring of my 8th grade year. Everything, my life was set. My voice teacher had arranged the recording studio because she saw my gifts and my talents and wanted to help me to make it big on the country music stage, which was my dream in life. But then 1 week into my freshman year of high school, my whole world was turned upside down. My best friend's mom was driving us to the movies when all of a sudden, as we were traveling down the rural two-lane highway, we were struck from behind. This sent our vehicle into a tailspin, which then proceeded to barrel roll multiple times until we finally landed in the field on the opposite side of the highway. With every roll, my head was at the point of impact. My best friend was the least injured of us all. All three of us survived. Her mom had to have multiple back surgeries and before she could finally get back to living her life. My friend flagged a young family down on the side of the road to get them to call 911. This was back in 2000, so not everybody had a cell phone, especially coming from the rural area in Southeast Kansas where I grew up. But luckily, this family stopped and called 911. Once the EMTs arrived on the scene, I had to be cut from the vehicle, resuscitated multiple times at the scene to get me stable enough to transport me to the rural hospital, where the doctors just weren't equipped with enough medical staff knowledgeable in what I needed, so I would need to be life-flighted to the nearest trauma center, an hour and a half away by car. Once my mom, my dad, my brother, and sister-in-law all met with the neurologist and the medical team, they would receive a very dim prognosis, less than a 25% survival rate. They informed my family that my brain was swelling rapidly and that I would need to be placed in a drug-induced coma to allow my brain the best chances of healing and allow me the best chance of survival. My grandparents were calling all of our family. Aunts, uncles, cousins all arrived at the hospital. Everyone had been awake for more than 24 hours. Aunts, uncles, grandparents, and cousins decided to go to get a hotel room, get some rest because I was stable. Then, in the middle of the night, on Sunday, I took a turn for the worse. My brain began swelling rapidly. It got up to 6 to 7 times the normal cranial pressure. It was in the middle of the night. There was a Calvary Baptist minister on the pediatric ICU unit that night who offered to come and pray with my family. My mom remembers in this prayer feeling a weight lifted off of her shoulders, and she knew in that moment that I was going to survive. It was approximately 1 hour after this prayer that my brain swelling began to go back down. Doctors were able to get me stable and get me out of the woods. Prayer is the most powerful thing that we have at our disposal. Prayers make miracles happen. I would remain in this coma for 3 weeks. The ventilator would be removed at 2 weeks. Once I woke out of my coma, I couldn't speak. I would answer questions by squeezing my right hand or blinking my left eye. I fatigued very, very quickly. Therapists would get me up for 30 minutes in the chair beside my bed, and I would sleep the rest of the day. On September 19th, I stood for the first time. Of course, I had therapists beside me holding me up because I had lost pretty much all of my muscle mass. It had been 24 days since I had been on my feet. How much do we all take for granted every day? Being able to walk to the refrigerator to get a glass of milk. Today, I'm sharing my story with you because this was a brand new beginning for me. The life that I knew was over. I would no longer be that beautiful, independent girl who had her whole dreams that I was chasing, making them a reality. In fact, that night was the night that all my dreams died. I had absolutely no idea the difficulty that I was going to face over the next 4 to 6 years of my life. I had no idea that my rehab and my recovery was not going to be the most difficult things that I would face over the next 4 to 6 years of my life. But little did I know in this moment that over the next 4 to 6 years, I would discover strategies that would not only help me in overcoming this tragedy and lead me to finding myself again, but that it would also lead to a much bigger reward. In the week following me standing for the first time, I would take 3 steps in the parallel bars, and then I would be transferred to an intensive therapy program at a subacute rehab unit in Kansas City, Missouri on September 27th, just a little over a month after the car accident. Still having no idea of the difficulty that would be in store for me, and that I would face my darkest moments in the next 4 to 5 years of my life. I still had to rely on someone to help me with absolutely everything, transferring, getting me out of bed. I couldn't do any of that on my own. I couldn't speak, so I would make my needs known by writing on a whiteboard and by blinking my left eye to answer questions. My voice pretty much defined who I was. I was known for my voice. People would hire me to sing all over the area. Do you have any idea what that must have been like? 43 days after that fateful night, as my mom walked into my hospital room that morning, I said, "Good morning and I love you," for the first time. Of course, my voice was nothing but a whisper because it was still very weak from having the ventilator in. Have you ever been hit with an experience that totally altered your life? Left you figuring out who this new person was? Or had a situation that just left you stuck with no way out? This was exactly where I was. As I reflect back on these early days, I had to focus on my recovery, the gains that I was making each day, being able to walk 3 steps one day, 5 steps the next. It was hard for me to remember my progress each day, but luckily, the therapist that I worked with, my mom, my family, they were all right there by my side to help remind me. Focusing on the positive is so important. Have you ever heard what you focus on grows? When it seems like you are being hit from every direction with negative, I encourage you to focus on the positive. Over time, I learned that every night before I went to bed, picking out 3 positives from the day would help me to be able to get through each day. Focus in on those positives. It's going to be hard in the beginning, because when you're being hit from every angle with negatives, finding the positives is going to be a little bit challenging. But as you continue to find those positives each and every day, you're going to see more and more. I promise you that. Deuteronomy 31:6 says, "Be strong and courageous. Do not fear or be in dread of them. For it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not leave you or forsake you." During these times, remembering that God is always with you is so important. He loves you, but he's asking you to turn to him and ask him for the help to keep going. He is the one thing that has never failed me, and he's carried me through every challenging moment of my life. He's always going to be there for you too. I promise you that. On October 13th, after being in the inpatient rehab for 2.5 weeks, I would be discharged home. Of course, I was still relying on a wheelchair to get me long distances because I was still very, very weak. Had to use a walker when I was up walking to maintain my balance, so I wasn't ready to go back to school. My mom and I would go home for Friday night and Saturday night, and then we would pile back into the car on Sunday afternoon, head back to Kansas City, Missouri to start a 7-week rehab program, Monday through Friday, 8 hours a day, physical therapy, occupational therapy, speech, and then working with the teacher to try to help me to get caught up on my homework. I still had no idea that my rehab would not be the most challenging thing that I would ever face. I would
incredible story.
I would be discharged right before Thanksgiving from this rehab center, go back to school half days, Thanksgiving through Christmas. It was then that I figured out what my most challenging obstacles would be. Once back in school, my friends' lives had gone on. They were still playing the sports we loved. They were still working their part-time jobs, going out on the weekends. I had to do therapy after school every day of the week. Schoolwork was so much more difficult for me. Had to hire tutors. My mom had to help me with all of my homework. So I was focused on schoolwork and my therapy. I felt alone. I felt isolated. My friends didn't even seem to care if I was around. That's what I perceived. It hurt. I dealt with judgment. My right eye was closed and would require 5 eye surgeries to get it back to functioning and looking more normal. The front part of my head was shaved from the pressure gauge that was in my skull while I was in my coma to monitor the brain swelling. My left arm was drawn up for years. It would be years before I could extend it and open my hand without prying my fingers open with my right hand. So those who didn't know of the accident or know me before would see something physically wrong with me and decide that I wasn't worth their time. Little did they know that I was fully with it up here, but they never wanted to get to know the beautiful person that I was on the inside. This hurt. This was the biggest challenge because I was no longer that beautiful, independent singer-songwriter whose life was set. It would be like this for years. But you know what? There was one thing that I could always count on to carry me through. That was God. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." I had a voice in my heart that, despite the multiple times a week for the next 4 to 5 years that I would come home from school and tell my parents that I should have died, I wish I was dead, I want to kill myself, that voice would bring me comfort and peace and keep me going. It said, "I have a plan for you. You have to keep going. You can't stop." I knew it was the voice of God. I would have given anything to have been able to talk to someone who had been through what I was going through when I was going through it, but I didn't have that. So I knew I had to be that for someone else. I knew I couldn't stop. So every night before I went to bed, I would pray to God and thank Him for my life and my blessings and ask Him to lead me and help me to make the right choices so that I could help those He placed in my path. I also prayed for everyone in the world because what I was going through, I wouldn't have wished on anyone. God will never fail you. I didn't always hear the voice in my heart, but when I was praying for something, I was able to keep my eyes open to new opportunities, and all of a sudden there would be a door that would open that I knew was from God and that I needed to walk through it. Matthew 19:26 says, "With man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." With God by your side, you can turn that impossible into I'm possible. That's exactly what I've been able to do. I got through high school, graduating with my class by the grace of God, went on to college where I continued to have more struggles, similar, dealing with judgment. I changed my major 4 times, finally graduated with my associate's degree in occupational therapy after 8 years. But it was then when I would walk through the door of a patient's room that had suffered a stroke, and they would tell me that I can't do this. And I could sit across from them and share with them my story. That would give them hope. They'd thank me on the day I would discharge them home and give me a hug and say, "Beth, I couldn't have gotten through this without you. Thank you." I loved working as an occupational therapist. I moved from Kansas to Texas in June of 2015. All of my coworkers and my friends were basically my coworkers, were all married or in relationships. So there was one thing missing in my life, and that was someone to share my life with. But I didn't have any way of meeting single people, so I started doing online dating. I can tell you that God will use any means necessary to get you where you need to be, even online dating. In July of 2016, I went out on a lunch date with someone through an online date, and he invited me to his church, but it was in a suburb of Waco, and I had only lived there a little over a year. I didn't know where China Spring, Texas was, so I never went. In November of 2016, I ended up moving to China Spring. Every time I passed the church, I would see his face, couldn't remember his name, and would think of the invitation. but I still didn't see God pointing me to the church, so I never went. Well, I thank goodness that God is persistent. He basically had to hit me upside the head to get me to the church. I'm just glad he didn't use a 2x4. The last Friday in January 2017, I was in Walmart at 7 a.m. buying cooking ingredients to do a cooking checkoff with a patient where I worked, when as I'm walking away from the cash registers, I hear a familiar voice talking to the cashier behind me. I think, I know that voice, but I don't know where I know it from. So I turned around. Lo and behold, it was the gentleman who had invited me to church on that lunch date. So I slowed down. He recognized me. We did small talk after our vehicles parked right beside each other. And then Saturday morning, I messaged him on the dating app and said, guess what? I moved to China Spring, Texas. I have yet to find a church that I feel at home at. What time is church? He told me to come to second service, that he would introduce me to all of his friends. I went to church that Sunday. He introduced me to all of his friends. Those friends became family to me. This was the first time that I felt like I belonged anywhere in 17 years. I had friends. I had a job I love. I had coworkers. 2 weeks after joining this church, I found out they had a Celebrate Recovery. Now, I didn't really know what Celebrate Recovery was, but I knew with the depression and the anxiety that I had learned to overcome that I could help people by sharing my story. So, Celebrate Recovery is what got me getting up on a stage and sharing my story to a bigger audience, more than just my patients. 2 months after joining this church, God spoke to me one night and told me that he brought me and this friend together to bring us both closer to him, and that I needed to tell him that I loved him and that God loved him. That night when God spoke to me, he allowed me to feel the unconditional love that he has for every single one of us. It's a love unlike anything else. God loves you. It doesn't make a difference your past if you make a mistake. He loves us all unconditionally. I promise you that. Nothing will ever change that. He also let me see inside this friend. He let me see that this friend had the potential to get out of all of the darkness and to rise above and make whatever was on his heart become a reality. I knew I had that potential. I have always had everything deep inside of me to make my dreams a reality. You do too. You may have to dig deep, but I promise you, you have everything within you to get out of whatever it is you're currently struggling with. And I know that's why God made me aware and showed me that night everything that he showed me, so that I can share that with you. You have everything within you to make your dreams a reality and get out of your darkness. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 states, God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with your testing, he will provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. I am living proof of this Bible verse. I wouldn't be here today if I didn't have everything in me to make it to where I am today. He is the one thing that will never fail you. I am stronger and more resilient, and I promise you, by not giving up and keep putting one foot in front of the other, you can become stronger and more resilient as well. Everything happens in God's time, and his time is so much greater than ours. His timing is perfect. Now, I'm not saying that I didn't have a lot of why me, why, I would beg and ask God that so many times over the last 2+ decades that I never got an answer, but a door would open to an opportunity that would reveal why. Because I needed to fulfill my purpose. I would come across natural solutions that would give me my life back in the spring of 2019. And then I would begin sharing these natural solutions with others. One of my clients, Barbara, hadn't been able to make a fist with her hands for over 4 years. And so she asked me if I had anything that could help her. I recommended the CBD topical and the CBD oil under her tongue. Within 1 week, she was able to make more of a fist, and her discomfort was getting better, but she wasn't there. So after 1 month, I checked on her and I said, "How are you doing?" And she looks up at me with tears in her eyes, holding up both hands, making a fist with both hands, and says, "Beth, you are my angel. I never dreamed I'd be able to do my job and no discomfort at all. And I'm doing it. Thank you." The clients that I can help using my natural solutions, they're so much more of a blessing to me than any of the benefits that I've seen. About a month after I started this business, I would meet my husband because I continued to do online dating. He was a giver and he was generous. That's what he let me see. After we got married in 2020, 4 to 6 months to a year into our marriage, his true nature began to reveal itself. His insecurities would bubble up to the surface. God was opening doors for me to be able to continue to speak and share my story on a much bigger level. But my husband would always tell me that the only financial security I would ever have is with my occupational therapy degree. I would never be able to have any income through my speaking at all. He would make me cry 1 to 2 times a month for over 2 years, telling me that I would never make anything with sharing my story. Anytime costs would rise, he would get down and tell me that I needed to bring in more money. I was working 2 to 3 days a week as an occupational therapist, able to pay half our bills plus our groceries. But he was still helping pay for his brother's car and other stuff financially for him, both his brother and his mother, which he always told me that they were family. He was always going to take care of them if they needed it. I got to where I couldn't share my goals and my dreams because he would just knock me down, say they weren't a reality, making me cry. Anytime costs would rise and he would go flip out because of me needing to bring in more money, I would say God would make a way. His response to me would be that God doesn't pay the bills. I knew better. God has always provided anything and everything I've ever needed. So his faith just wasn't where mine was. Psalms 50:15 says, "And call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you and you shall glorify me." That has always been my purpose. Me sharing my story and what God has done for me in my life, that's to glorify Him and to share with others who don't know the Lord so that they know that He's going to make a way where there's no way. He is the one thing that you can always turn to lift you up in your time of need, but you have to ask. In March of this year, I had the opportunity to do a 2-day speaking seminar that would get me a professional demo reel for my website of me sharing a short little clip of my story, professional pictures for my website, It was amazing because after I spoke, people would stand up and say, "Wow, you have to take your story nationwide today. You can help so many people." At the end of that week, my old friend that I hadn't seen in over 3 years, hadn't been close to in over four, reached out to my best friend in Waco asking about me. I thank goodness that God, again, is consistent, always uses that same person to get me where I need to be. He doesn't give up. He's a patient and a loving God. And God's timing is always perfect. On Monday, April 3rd, I would get a call from the coach who did that 2-day speaking seminar. And he told me that I had been chosen to get the scholarship for his 4-month speaking coaching program to get me to where I could find and get paid speaking opportunities to continue to share my story with so many more people. I was a bit afraid to share this with my husband because I knew it wasn't going to go over well. That night, I cooked dinner, we ate, and after dinner, I shared with him the news of the coaching program. His response to me was, "Until I see in writing there are no fees involved, you are not allowed to do it." I immediately started crying. He glared at me and said in a nasty voice, "Why are you crying?" And I responded to him and said, "Because this is who I am. This is what God has called me to do, and He's opening doors to make it a reality, and you're telling me I can't do it." He said, "I'm just looking out for us. This is a businessman. He's only out to take from you what he can get from you financially. He doesn't want to help you." I knew better because I had been doing networking for over 2 years, and I had met many business owners that would give what they could, their knowledge, help other business owners out in any way possible, so that if ever they got to where they needed something, they would receive whatever they needed. When you give of yourself, that's when you receive sometimes blessings bigger than you could have asked or imagined. I knew in that moment that I had to get out. So I made my escape plan that week. I called the director of therapy where I worked to try to find out if I could transfer from the hospital in Dallas to the hospital back in Waco. And I was able to. I applied for an apartment that I could afford and was approved within 24 hours. By Saturday, I was ready to get out and protect myself. Psalms 91:11 says, "For he will order his angels to protect you wherever you go." God moved mountains for me that week. I had lost my peace when I got married and moved to Dallas. When I came back to Waco, I found my peace again. I was back where I belonged, doing what I needed to do to glorify God. I know that you're watching this for a reason. I know you have everything inside of you to get through whatever struggles, whatever challenges you're facing right now in this moment. But you can't stop. I believe in you, and I'm asking you to believe in yourself. Belief is so powerful. The one thing that has always stopped me and left me feeling stuck and lost with no way out has been anxiety and fear of the unknown. But over time, I learned that I couldn't let the fear stop me. I'm telling you right now, don't let the fear stop you. I'm going to let you in on a little secret. What fear really is, fear is false evidence appearing real. So you have to keep putting one foot in front of the other. I know you have everything within you to make it through whatever you're being challenged with right now. It's in my reflection of the last two plus decades of my life that I realized that I did discover strategies that got me through every obstacle, every darkness I have ever faced, that just added to that fear and anxiety. And now I'm still here today so that I can teach these same strategies to you, so that you too can regain your lives in the same way that I have regained mine, grow stronger, grow more confident, and become resilient just like I have, despite all of the circumstances that are trying to stop you. Prayers make miracles happen. Never stop asking for the Lord to be your strength and to lead you. Focus on the positive, especially through the hard times. And never forget that with God by your side, nothing is impossible. You can change that impossible into I am possible. And never stop believing in yourself. Also, stop letting those who judge you and don't have your best interest at heart, stop letting them affect you. Put up boundaries. They don't deserve any of your time. As I mentioned before, the strategies that I discovered, I have a gift for each of you. I have a free download of my EI method to finding peace. This is 5 steps that you can take to reset in 30 seconds or less when you're feeling anxious, when you're feeling depressed, when you're feeling lost. So I encourage you to download it. You'll see the link in the comments with this post. You can also go to elizabethinspires.com and find the download there. I encourage you to download it, print it off, and place it wherever you need it most. If you need it in multiple places, print off multiple copies so that you can turn to it whenever you're feeling lost and feel like you don't have anywhere to go and no way out. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing your story with us and your 30-second reset for peace. I'm sure that people will find that very useful if they're trying to overcome challenges in their life. Is there one thing you'd like to leave the audience with today, Elizabeth?
Just don't ever stop believing in yourself. And when you are really struggling and you feel like you don't have anyone to talk to, turn to God. Talk to Him. So many nights when I didn't have someone that I could talk to, I would cry myself to sleep talking to God, letting Him know what was on my heart. He knows what's going on in your heart and within you, but He wants you to turn to Him and ask Him for help, ask Him for guidance, and just let Him know what you're struggling with. I promise you, He won't fail you and He will help you through.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for tuning in to another empowering episode of the You World Order Showcase podcast. We hope you've enjoyed hearing from our incredible life, health, and transformational coaches who are making a profound impact on the world. Remember, change begins with you, and you have the power to transform your life and the lives of others. If you want to take that next step and unlock your true potential, visit thecoachesalchemist.com, where you can find the 3 ways we can help you for free to spin your talent into gold with clarity, a system, and a plan. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button so you never miss an inspiring episode. And if you enjoyed today's show, we'd greatly appreciate it if you could leave us a review on your favorite podcast platform. Your feedback means the world to us and helps us reach more people with our positive message. Stay connected with us on social media for updates, behind-the-scenes content, and upcoming guest announcements. You can find us on Facebook at the You World Order or simply visit thecoachesalchemist.com.